did your faces really show that you were happy? Can't hear me. Okay. Say something. Am I talking? I just said I didn't see as many happy faces as I expected to with the last song when you're supposed to be clapping and all of those kind of things. But, Joni, you made my day. You were back there singing on Do Lord like I have never seen you sing before, and it was marvelous. She had her face going, just all the words, she knew them. She didn't mind that nobody else was singing around her. She was happy.
Amen.
She came to church and she was happy.
Amen.
What a thought. Good morning. Welcome to our August 7th Sunday worship service. My name is Natalie, and I'm the worship leader for today. And we have a few announcements, of course. One being that the SPRC committee will meet tomorrow at 6 p.m. And another is the visitation of Diana Braden is scheduled for Tuesday, August the 9th, at Dwayne Spence Funeral Home in Canal Winchester, at 10 a.m. with a funeral to follow at noon. Now, we are being reminded that when you go to O'Charley's in Groveport this Thursday, the 11th, and present a flyer that is now available on the table out in the foyer, and I checked and it really is there, present that flyer with your meal, and they will donate 15% of your total to the Groveport Madison Human Needs. So now you have a really good excuse to go and eat some of those wonderful yeast rolls. I'm just saying, that's on the 11th. Please pick up a... Okay, well, it was written as Groveport here, but yes, the only one I know of is the one that's down in, yeah, on Gender. So, anyway, I like their roles. I'll just let it go at that. Now, the Education Committee also wants to remind you, have you marked your calendar, that the JAM session, and that stands for Jesus and Me, which is a wonderful time with kids that we want to encourage to come back, is scheduled now for Saturday, October the 15th. They're going to need a lot of volunteers because many hands will make the work lighter. Amen. And a lot of creative minds. So you can come to the education meeting with those ideas. I don't know what the theme is, and that's okay, because I know it's in good hands.
It's about food.
Food. Like manna?
Uh-huh.
Ah, manna from God?
You got it.
Whoa. And maybe food trucks?
No.
No food trucks?
No.
Okay. It was just a thought, people. Okay. Let's see. And they are encouraging us to go to Sunday school at 9 o'clock. That's every Sunday morning at 9. I saw the groups. I heard somebody was listening to Close Encounters of the Third Kind, which is really one of my favorite movies ever, but we'll let it go at that. Also, Julie Hardbarger is the person to see if you are interested in helping with the Henderson mission trip in September. Asbury Steppers are still stepping on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. in Brobst Park. Come and join them. Dinner and Bible Study is still studying Women of the Bible, but I don't know who they're studying, and since I don't see Oscar Jr., I can't ask him. But
Esther,
Queen Esther?
Yes.
Whoa, now that's a story. So, I mean, that would be a really good study to come to. Yes. And Monday morning Bible study is still planning to meet again beginning August 15th. And they're going to be studying Samson and Delilah, or Judges 13 through 16. And all are invited, of course, to attend. Pastor Sherri, you have some announcements?
Not ready.
Sorry.
I do just have a couple of announcements for you. The first one involves Mike Brown's memorial service and repast. And if you recall, Mike Brown is Demetrius Brown's father. So this is his memorial service and repast. It is at Hilltop United Methodist Church. The address is 99 South Highland Avenue in Columbus. It is Saturday, August 13th, gathering from 11 to noon with the memorial service at noon, and then the meal and fellowship to follow in the church basement. So remember that that is Demetrius Brown's father, Mike Brown's memorial service next Saturday. And personally, I would like to offer a special thank you to Cindy Byers, to Stan Nason, to Connie Stevens, and to Angie Rogers. They all came out and helped participate with the turn fair yesterday. It was a good turnout in a good location. My answer to prayer personally was that rain would hold off. And then when there was a downpour, we couldn't tell that anybody left. So thanks be to God for that. The kids got their backpacks filled. Relationships were forged within members of this territory. But a special thank you to those who came out and helped me because I couldn't do it by myself. And so let's just say thanks to them. Because they represented you well. So that's the end of my announcement. So I don't even know what's next. It's not my job. I guess stand for the call to worship.
No, listen to her.
And just as a reminder, you have a green insert in your bulletin. Check that for any other announcements that we maybe didn't cover this morning or as a reminder throughout the week, what's coming up. I have become enamored by the writings of a woman on Facebook, like a lot of people. But this is because it has animals in it, and it's two friends, and one's a bear, and one's a rabbit. And they're very philosophical, and they support each other, and they love each other, you can tell this. But it just happened that a couple days ago, this popped up, and I wanted to share it. "Sometimes the best thing to do is just let go," said Bear. "Let go of what?" said the rabbit. "Fear, doubt, expectations," replied Bear. "And then what?" asked the little rabbit. "Have faith," said the bear. Now today you chose to come to church, to this church. I think it was a good choice. You have faith when you come here that you're going to hear a well-grounded sermon. And you have faith that you will feel the Holy Spirit in this place. You have faith that you will be surrounded by a caring church family. And you have faith that you will find your moment of peace here in this sanctuary. You chose well to come today. Take just a moment as we enter service and breathe in that peace that you're seeking, that you have found with this family. Let go of the worries that are behind you or the concerns that are in front of you for this coming week. And know that, as we've heard before in our sermons, God's got it under control. And just be. Let's worship God together this day with the call to worship. Please rise as you are able. Praise God for things seen like clouds and grass and oceans and trees. Praise God for fathers and mothers, for families, for friends.
Praise God for all our blessings, future, present, and past.
Praise God for the gift of faith. Amen. The opening song, "Great is Thy Faithfulness," number 140.
Thank you.
please be seated. Just a reminder, I'll make a couple of announcements, but a reminder, always check your green bulletin because we don't always announce what's already printed. There's some concern. I wanted to list a couple announcements that are printed. The ones that we spoke aloud aren't printed, but reminder that Jean Gifford's funeral is also Saturday at 11. And also, we didn't announce this either, but just a reminder, the Finance Committee meeting is at 3 o'clock tomorrow. So there are other things. When we say check the green bulletin, always remember to do that, because sometimes what we announce are the things that didn't make it into the green bulletin, or the insert, sorry, insert. That's what I'm trying to say. So double check that, and now our minds are all clear. I hope you're apprised of everything, but check the bulletin, because my mind isn't what it used to be. My nothing is what it used to be. But with a laugh on our hearts, let us bow to God in prayer. Oh, holy God, you are in fact the creator of the stars and the heavens, and we pray that you reveal yourself in a mighty way to us this day, however you choose to reveal yourself. We have faith that we will see what you want us to see. God, reveal all the things that are beneficial for us to know. Oh, holy God, God of redemption, God who calls people to faith, who calls people to discipleship, who calls people to service, remind us again of the miracles and the ministries, those of the past, those that are on our hearts that need to be rekindled, and those that are before us, those things that we hope for but don't yet see. May the spark of the Spirit reignite our vision, our passion, our determination, in short, our faith. God, you are not only the creator of all life, the sender of all life, and the sustainer of all life, but we belong to you. So renew now in each one of us our faith. Remind us that what we see in the world has nothing to do with who you are or who we are because we belong to you. God, we turn ourselves over to you. We turn this sacred space over you. And the sacred space is the territory that we occupy and the time that we occupy. We turn all of this over to you. Come, Holy Spirit, come, be set free. Touch us again, that our faith would rise, our light would shine, and others might come to know Jesus. It is in his name that we pray and do all things. Amen.
Morning. How's it going? Yeah, I'm not feeling it today. Just kind of there. I didn't prepare a scripture. I didn't print any pictures. I don't have a book. I kind of sort of didn't even plan this kid's moments. Just winging it. Not sure how that's going to go. Not feeling perky. Odd for me. Really, quite. God is perky. He forgot to spread it around on me today. So I'm not feeling it. I didn't really prepare for today. I prepare for things usually. Sometimes I wing it and I nail it. Sometimes I wing it and I fall. There will be some of you pointing no fingers, that will be like, it's okay, honey, you did fine. There will be some of you, not pointing fingers, that will be like, what was that? There will be one of you who will say, you were fabulous. I love my mother. I know. I'm just not feeling it. Did you ever have those? You're just not feeling it? And you're like, wow, I totally bombed that because I'm just not feeling it. I want you to know that the one person the Trinity, would never look at you or me and go, wow, you totally failed. Never. Won't happen. No matter how much you don't plan for something, no matter how much you don't read a scripture, no matter how much you don't read that book or print a picture or prepare for a kid's moments, the Trinity will never say to you, wow, you totally bombed that. Just won't happen. And there will be some people who will just constantly laugh at whatever you're saying. And I'm perfectly fine with that too. So what's important here is that even though I maybe didn't plan for this, I got asked to do it and I'm like, yeah, sure. I got asked 2 weeks ago and I was like, yeah, sure. It's in my calendar, yeah, sure. And maybe I didn't plan for it. And maybe I'm not perky. And you're not used to seeing me not perky, unless you're pretty close to me and then you've seen me not perky. It's okay. You don't have to always be perky. You don't have to always not bomb. And it's okay. Because it doesn't matter what some people might say and what other people might say. It always matters what my mother says. Always. And it always matters what the Trinity says. Everybody feeling that? Okay, now what's important here is you also need to understand what this kid's moments just took out of me. Because I came in here, how perky was I this morning? How perky? Sharon? Exactly. And oh, let me bring it down. And pretend that I didn't plan this 4 days ago. So it's okay. Back to me, back to perky. Hello, children of God. Let's have a repeat after me prayer. Wow, that took a lot out of me. Let's have a repeat after me prayer. Dear God, I thank you so much. Because I just can't not do that perky thing. Y'all don't have to say all of that. Just that was from me. Thanks for perky, God. We thank you for our blessings. And in Jesus' name we say, amen. There you go. I'll need to know that. That just took a lot out of me. If you're playing a ding-a-ling bell, she's going to say something. I have no clue, but she's got a mic. Follow what she...
Some of you may not have played the bells before. And so look at what color your bell is, and every time I hold up a card and it has your color on it, you ring it, as long as you see that card, and then stop it when you don't, okay? Now, the only problem I see is that we have two shades of blue, light blue and dark blue, now that you know, and if you don't have to worry about it, if you can't get it mixed up, it'll still sound okay, okay? The first song we're going to do today is called Blessed Assurance. And it was written about 150 years ago by Fran of Crosby, who was blind, and her friend wrote the music to it. So it's been around for 150 years. We're ready.
That really is fun to listen to. Thanks, Connie, and everyone. And some of you smiled. Remember, it's okay to smile in church, especially when there's music involved, all those kind of things. All right. In the 11th chapter of Hebrews, we hear these words under the heading of, "What is faith?" Faith means being sure of the things that we hope for and knowing that something is real even if we do not see it. Faith is the reason we remember great people who have lived in the past. It is by faith that we understand that the whole world was made by God's command, so what we see was made by something that cannot be seen. It was by faith that Abraham obeyed God's call to go to another place that God promised to give him. Abraham left his own country, not knowing really where he was to go. It was by faith that Abraham lived like a foreigner in that country that God promised to give him. He lived in tents with Isaac and Jacob, who had received that same promise from God. Abraham was waiting for the city that had real foundations, the city planned and built by God. Now, Abraham was too old to have children, and Sarah had been told that she could not have children. But it was by faith that Abraham was made able to become a father because he trusted God to do what God had promised. Abraham was so old that he was almost dead. But from that line just really, anyway. Abraham was so old that he was almost dead. But from him came many descendants, as there are stars in the sky, like the sand on a seashore. His descendants could not be counted. All these great people died in faith. They did not get the things that God promised God's people, but they saw them coming far in the future, and they were glad. And when people say such things, they show that they are looking for a country that will be their own. And if they had been thinking about the country that they had left, they could have gone back. But they were waiting for something better, a better country, a heavenly country. So God was not ashamed to be called their God, because God had prepared a city for them. The word of God for the people of God.
Centuries. It has been estimated that it will be performed 11 million times a year. And you are going to be part of that number today. Ready?
The cards. Raise your cards up higher. Put those up higher so they can see them. There you go.
Oh. I can't do it that way. Can't see it from there. I can. You can see it.
Well,
I can see it.
He's getting you some books to help raise.
Whoa! Thank you, Mr. Gregg. Okay.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Oh God, you are the God of hope, and by faith we know that you created the world and all that is in it. You are the author of all things unseen, understood, misunderstood, fathomable, and unfathomable. We pray now that you open our eyes to your presence among us and open our minds, our hearts, our spirits, our ears to hear your word, that we might understand its meaning and accurately apply it, that our faith might grow, our witness might grow, our lives might transform and help transform others. By your authority, may it be your word and your word only that is shared and received in this place today. Amen. By faith. Faith looks different at different times, doesn't it? Sometimes it looks perky, and sometimes not so much. And sometimes a pastor walks in going, well, that example I had was terrible, God, but I'm going to trust you. And then the children's message gives the example. But faith looks different in different situations. Except faith is really the same, regardless of the situation. Now, the word faith, most of us use it, especially in church, we use it a lot. And it's actually defined as belief in or trust in or loyalty to. And if you actually push it a little bit further, you can get a little bit more complicated words like conviction or allegiance, as in allegiance to someone or something. But for me, if you think about the definitions in a dictionary, for example, and then if you look back to Hebrews 11, regardless of what translation you get, you find words like this. Faith is the reality of what we hope for, the reality of what we hope for, the proof of what we don't see. That's the common English Bible translation. And Natalie just read for us these words. Faith is being sure of the things we hope for and knowing that something is real, even if we don't see it. If you think about it, isn't that faith in a nutshell? That you believe regardless of whatever. Faith is what we have. And by faith is how we achieve salvation through Jesus Christ. Faith is, or at least should be, at the core of who we are, and it's by faith that God transforms us from who and what we were to who we are and who we can and one day will be. Faith. It's a simple five-letter word, and we throw it around all the time, especially when we talk about God, at least in the church. We use words like faith and obedience all the time, and we know what they mean, but how often do we stop and just focus on faith? You know, I don't know about you, but when I think about faith and what it really means, for whatever reason, there's another peace that always comes into my head, because maybe it's what I need, but it's a different take on faith, if you will. And it comes from Mark 9, verse 24 is the one I want to share. And some of you will have heard it. It's a simple verse that says, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. That's talking about faith. Lord, I have faith, but help my lack of faith. Help me have more faith. Lord, I believe, but help me have more faith. Now, in the Mark verse, which we're stepping toward for just a second, because we're going to be in Hebrews, if you're not familiar, it's a story of a father of a boy that has an evil spirit. And he goes to the disciples and says, please cast this spirit out. And they aren't able to do anything. So he goes right to Jesus. And Jesus' first reaction is to say to the disciples, you faithless bunch, what's the deal? Because they had the authority to do it. They had the faith, they should have had the faith to do it, but they were unsuccessful. And then the father, a lot of times you miss this in the scripture, he says, Lord, if you can, cast this demon out. So he knows to go to Jesus. But Jesus picks up on those words, and he challenges them. What do you mean, if I can? All things are possible to those who believe. That's the faith piece. All things are possible to those who believe. And then the Father responds, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. Lord, I have faith, but help my lack of faith. Lord, I believe, but help me have more faith. How often, if we're honest, do those words ring true? How often, even in the church, do we, whose lives are built on faith, who have received salvation by faith, how often do we really, when we go to God, say, Lord, if you can? Don't say out loud, just think about it. Even if we don't use those words, how many times do we ourselves go to Jesus with the attitude of, Lord, if you can? Because that's so close to, Lord, if you will. But one refers to a lack of faith, and the other is an acknowledgement of faith. Lord, if you will, is completely different from Lord, if you can. Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. Lord, I have faith, but help my lack of faith. As we read on in Hebrews 11, do you notice what's there? Now, you notice first we skipped some verses. But what's there if you take the whole passage, or even it's there if you skip those verses in between, we read about our foreparents in the faith. And when I read that, I also think about faith and doubt because they go hand in hand. I think that when we believe, we still have room to believe more. Because if we're honest, we have those days when we're not perky. We have those days that our prayers really are more of a Lord, if you can, instead of a Lord, if you will. And sometimes we are in that perky place and we know that God will and we stand on our faith and all is good. But Hebrews 11 really is in a way an acknowledgement that sometimes we need that lift to get our perkiness back, because it offers us the encouragement of those who had faith before us, and it reminds us of why they had to have faith. It talks about Abraham, and we forget Abraham was a wealthy man. He had all of the benefits of a good life at that time, and God says, step away from that and go to a land you don't know and really don't take anything with you but your family. And he does. And we read about that all the time, but have you ever stopped and really thought about how much faith that took? I don't know about you, but I do like my stuff. I'm working on not liking it so much, but it makes us comfortable where we are, right? And I'm not a wealthy person. It would be hard as a wealthy person to have this God that's basically unknown to most people say, leave all of the fine life and just go somewhere. I'll let you know where you're going. Just start moving. And you're going to go to a foreign land, and you'll get there someday. And then I'm going to bless you forever and ever and ever. And he went. And what was the other thing God promised? And we laughed about it in the scripture. He was going to be the father of many nations. And I picked this scripture partly because of the translation. Abraham was, by our standards, almost dead. He was not a young man. Did anybody get that?
We did after
And Sarah, it didn't matter her age, even though she was not a young woman, because she was told she couldn't have kids. And yet they trust God, this God that few people know, that that's going to happen, and they walk away from all their wealth and just go where God sends them. I don't know about you, but that's an inspiring story, because we also know how that ends, right? God is with them every step of the way, even when they screw up, even when they're not perky, God is there. That is faith. And Abraham is not the only one that's talked about. Go check out the verses that are skipped. There's only 4, 5, 6, and 7. There are other of our exemplars in the faith. There's Abel, Enoch, Noah, other examples that are supposed to inspire us. They're really there to inspire the Hebrews that when the letter's being written, but they're there preserved in the Bible to inspire us. Faith is the reality of what we hope for, the proof of what we don't see. Because if we see it, No faith is required. Do you realize that many of them in those scriptures held on to promises that didn't fulfill themselves in their lifetimes, but God showed them the fulfillment long into the future, and that was enough? Is that enough for us? Do we live, not what we say, because we can say all kinds of churchy stuff. Churches are good at church language, right? But we talk about faith. Do we act like we have faith? And if not, there's good news. Hebrews 11 is what we're in today to give us a boost, to bring us from dragging in kind of tired because the weather sucks. It's humid. We're sick of it, right? It's not snow, though, right? Not snow. But we're tired. We want to sleep in. We want to be in a pool, right? I know I speak for a lot of us. And yet we drag in, but we have faith that God's going to give us what we need while we're here. That's why we're here. That's faith. And sometimes that's easy. There are some times when we are the Lord we believe. But then there are those other times when we are the Lord help our unbelief. And we have to be honest about that. And there's no shame in it, right? Because first of all, we know we're not the first, if you read through the scriptures. But if you don't read anywhere else, look in Hebrews 11. They needed encouragement, right? That's what it's for. So would God send encouragement if they weren't lagging somehow, if they didn't need a boost? You can answer, no, God wouldn't need to. Don't we all need a boost sometime? Sometimes, truthfully, we are the Lord we believe. And sometimes we are the Lord help our unbelief, but it's all by faith. What's important is what is it we put our faith in? Because that's really what it comes back to. Do we put our faith in the God of the scriptures, the God who is worthy of our faith? Does everybody? Some people put their faith in unworthy beings or things. Some people put their faith in their intellect, which will only go so far. Some people put their faith in their material possessions, which will only go so far. We put our faith in a God which will go forever and then some. And we need to remember that when we are the Lord we believe, but we also need to remember it when we are the Lord help our unbelief. And if you don't know where to look, you can start with Hebrews 11. And that should inspire you. Because think about those people. Think about Abel. What happened to him was wrong, but he had God's favor because of his faith, his attitude. Think about Noah. I'm glad I'm not Noah, because that would have been hard to be faithful when everybody's laughing at you and making fun of you, and it's hot and dry, and you're in the middle of a drought building a big boat, putting all your resources into it, having the ridicule of your neighbors day in and day out. We kind of take it for granted. We skip over that idea because we know how it worked out for him too, better than his neighbors, right? Good for all of us because look at what we've got because he was faithful. There are examples of faith throughout the scriptures because people encounter in their real lives faith challenging, faith draining experiences. But our faith stays true. Not because of who we are, but because of whose we are, because of the God of our faith, and because we are saved not by ourselves, but by faith in a God who is worthy. Being sure of things we hope for, and knowing that something is real even when we don't see it. How often do we see God, literally see God as a being like me? We have to know what to look for. We have to be ready to see when God makes God's presence known. But the first step to that is believing that God is real and God will do it. And if you have that, you have enough because God will do the rest. That's what our faith tells us, and our faith is right. And we've seen it throughout the scriptures time and again. Right now, it's a discouraging time to be the church. Am I right? Everything says the church is dead. But do we believe that? Is God dead? If God's not dead, the church isn't dead. And God will let us know when God has left the building. And I mean the metaphorical church, not the literal building. God will let us know. And I, for one, haven't gotten the message that God has left the building. The God of our faith is just as strong today as in Genesis and Exodus and Hebrews. and any other time in history. It doesn't matter what the world says. Our faith is in a God who is able to do anything. God spoke everything into existence just by God's word. And so we need to remember that, particularly when we are not feeling perky, particularly when the ways of the world and the people of the world and the statements of the world get us down and cause those doubts to come out. We remember the Lord we believe and all the stories because we need them to lift us up when we are the part that says, help my unbelief. Sometimes we're sure of the things we hope for. And sometimes our faith lags and we have to reach back out and get a fresh dose of God. Because it's not just about me. It's not just about you. It's about us together. Because our faith is individual, but our faith is also communal. God is a holy community. One in three, three in one. We're all connected. And it reminds me of a song. Some of you may have heard it. Some of you may not have. I'm not going to sing it, so don't get nervous. But there's just a part that I wanted to share. There's some words that, to me, it comes to my mind when I think of faith. Because when I'm down, God sends somebody to lift me up. And I know that when others are down, sometimes God sends me. And if I go, I can lift them up. But hear the words of this song. It says, I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. So stand with me. Agree with me. You are important to me. I need you to survive. That's the church. We need each other. We lift each other up because all of us are in this by faith. And it's faith in a God who is more than worthy of our faithfulness. The words of the song accurately express our connectedness to God and to one another. And so we draw on one another regardless of what's going on in the world outside. That's our faith. Lord, we have faith. Help us have more faith. Lord, we will serve you, but help us serve you better. We talk about faith all the time in church, but when's the last time you really examined your faith to consider the things that you're sure about, that you hope for, and the things that you're wavering on? Where are those things that stress you? We must have faith. We must have faith. Because it is by faith that we are saved. It is by faith in God that our sins are forgiven and our lives are transformed. It is by faith and nothing else, because we can't do it by ourselves. And we all know that, but sometimes our patterns of belief, I mean behavior, not belief, sometimes our patterns of behavior can take us down that path of trying to earn our salvation. If I just do it well enough, if I serve God enough, if I'm in church enough, my presence is enough. It's all about faith. If you never come to church, and I'm not saying don't, if you never come to church, but you believe in God, that counts for something. If you're in church every Sunday, but you don't believe in God, that's not going to get you anywhere. And sometimes people get it mixed up. It starts with being in church, but hopefully, if you come to church without faith, that is to lead you to faith. Because there are times when life gets tough, when things and objects get in the way of our faith. But our heroes of the faith inspire us. Our God inspires us. And when doubts creep in, because sometimes doubts creep in when it feels like God hasn't heard our prayers. Sometimes doubt creeps in when somebody that you love dies. It doesn't matter if they're young or old, if they were sick or well, if there was an illness or an accident or it just happened. When somebody you love dies, how is it with your soul and how is it with your faith? When you don't get that raise you deserve, how is it with your faith? When you don't get that promotion that was a sure thing, how is it with your faith? When you don't get accepted into the college or program that you were counting on desperately, how is it with your faith? When you get fired or laid off, how is it with your faith? When you're evicted or your home goes into foreclosure, how is it with your faith then? What happens if your car gets repossessed, and not just repossessed, but in front of all your coworkers? How is it with your soul then? When you have to file for bankruptcy, or when you have to file a restraining order against the one that you have loved well for a long time, how is it with your faith then? When you are hit with Alzheimer's or dementia or a stroke or some other major debilitating disease, or when somebody that you love or care for has that happen? How is it with your faith? When your child runs off and you don't know where they are, how is it with your faith? When there is an affair or addiction or mental illness, how is it with your faith then? When someone that you love lies to you or steals from you, how is it with your faith? In all these potentially depleting experiences, when the world or even your brain is telling you that God is not real, how is it with your faith then? Because when you're not perky, when you are struggling with your faith, in those experiences when you are the help my unbelief, God is still worthy of your faith because God never changed. God is the same in all those experiences, when you get the promotion and when you don't, when your loved ones are safe and when they're not, when you are well and when you're sick, God is the same. And our faith should be, and it can be, if we remember who God is, and if we're willing to be honest and go to the ones we know who pray for us and love us and whose faith is strong when ours is weak. We're all connected. Sometimes I'm weak and I need you to pray for me so I can hold on to my faith. And sometimes you're weak and you need me to pray for you and come to you so you can hold on to your faith. That's what church is. And that's really what it's all about. It's not about all these peripherals. It's not about carpets and all these other things that we put. They affect our worship experience, but they don't save anybody. How is it with your faith when things get tough? And that question, or the answer to that question, matters. Because think about all the people right outside this building that have those same things going on, and they don't have the faith to help them, and they don't have the church family to help them. Do you think they really care that our church is fighting over homosexuality when somebody's laid off, or when somebody has Alzheimer's and that person keeps getting out of the house and they don't know how to keep them safe? Do you think they care what we're fighting about in church? They just need something to have faith in, and they're having faith in the wrong things because we're forgetting. We say the faith part, but we have to remember that same faith. It's the evidence of things we don't see, and we have to be honest. Sometimes we are the help our unbelief, and I'm talking about we, the church universal. What are the things that helped you keep your faith? More importantly, who are the faith heroes in your life that inspired you when you weren't perky, when you were the help my unbelief? Who are those faith heroes? I'm not talking about Abel or Abraham. I'm talking about the person in your life, your Sunday school teacher, your grandmother, your neighbor, the cashier at the bank. Who are the heroes of your faith that God put in your path when you needed just a little boost to get from the help my unbelief back to the Lord I believe? Remember those faith heroes. Remember those stories when you are down. And then you know what the other piece is? Share those stories with the people that you know, because those stories, like the stories of Hebrews 11, will lift them up too. All of us sometimes need a little bit of help to keep our faith. It's all by faith, and it's all by faith in the God that is worthy, and God will pick us up wherever we are, but sometimes God calls on us to remember the heroes of our faith, to remember those stories, and to tell them to somebody else. So who are the heroes of your faith, and what part of your story will you tell someone today? It is all by faith. Sometimes we believe, but sometimes we are the ones who need God to help our unbelief. Will you let God do that? And will you let God use you to do that for someone else? Let us prepare to pray. God, we thank you, first of all, that we know you through faith. That our faith matters because you matter, because you are bigger than any circumstance we will encounter. You have already brought victory to us. for we have eternal life, not because of us, because we wouldn't have that because of us, but because of you, because you are worthy, because you love us, because you forgive us, because you lift us up in the dark moments. Help us claim that faith again. God, we believe, but help our unbelief. We have faith, but help those moments when our faith wavers. Help us be stronger in our faith, and help us inspire others that they may know you or be stronger in their faith, that together we will collectively bring forth your kingdom, whether the world likes it or not, because it is not the world's choice, God. It is your choice. This we claim in your name. Amen. I want to lift up our prayer concerns now, and we have one praise report, and then we are going to take them to God, the same God of our faith, who is capable of everything else, is capable of ministering to all of them and all their needs. So we pray for the family of Diana Braden, who died Monday evening. We pray for the family of Mean Jean Gifford, who died in May, but again, we're going to be celebrating her life on Saturday at 11. We pray for a friend of Sharon and Steve Cox, Jessica, I think it's Zemini. God knows the pronunciation if I got it wrong. But Jessica's seizures have started up again, so we want to pray for her doctors to figure out the cause of those seizures. We want to pray for a friend going through a professional crisis. We want to pray for Logan Liuzzo. He's the son of the senior pastor over there at Fellowship Baptist. His cancer has grown. The treatment that had been working is no longer working, and the growth is significant since the last scan. So they have three treatment options. None is a cure, and they don't know what to expect because his cancer is so rare. But tomorrow they have to decide on a course of treatment. So they're asking for God's will to intervene, and they're praying for wisdom, healing, and then God's assistance. So if you would remember that family. And we want to also lift up a praise that Wilma's sister Marlene is expected to go home tomorrow or Tuesday. So and these are the things we are speaking aloud, but let us go to God on behalf of these and other prayer concerns. Let us go. Let us pray. God, you still are the God of our faith, and you don't waver, even though sometimes we do. God, we know you as a forgiving God, and yet you know how easy it should be for us to celebrate your faithfulness, your forgiveness, and your love. And sometimes, God, even though we know you, we fail in celebrating. Sometimes, God, our faith fails us, or maybe we fail our faith, God. And sometimes we have to look at Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Sarah and all the other examples in the scriptures meant to inspire us. And yet, truthfully, God, sometimes instead of being inspired, we allow their stories to make us feel diminished and unworthy or less than. And yet, God, that is the work of the enemy. When we feel that life is unfair, unpleasant, or just ugly, we confess that we doubt sometimes. God, we need you to help us see you in all things. We need you to bolster our faith when it is down. And we need you to point us to the ones who we know and the ones that we've just met who need us to testify to bolster their faith. We come before you now in faith, lifting up the names and situations that we spoke aloud, and lifting up the names and situations that we have whispered in the privacy of our hearts. God, we believe. Help our unbelief. But we believe that you will and can fix whatever needs to be fixed. How you fix it is up to you. We may not understand, but we accept it because we pray in faith. Forgive our distraction, forgive our arrogance, forgive our sometimes self-serving ways. Put us back on the right path. Show us who you want us to be, and then help us by faith be precisely who that is. Thank you, God, for hearing. Thank you for honoring this prayer. Thank you for being a God who is worthy of all our faith and more. It is in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we do pray to you, God. Amen.
With faith in Christ and with love for our neighbors of the world and for our immediate community, let us humbly present our offerings to God, who is our provider. Please accept these tithes, gifts, and offerings, and bless and multiply them so that they may be used in ministries and activities that inspire and increase faith in us and in everyone that we encounter. May they birth hope, holiness, and forgiveness in us, in our neighborhood, in our city, and across the globe, everywhere your Spirit resides today, and where it will reside tomorrow. Amen.
Communion? What? Oh, please be seated. I thought she was telling me it's not communion. That's what. No, you were just prompting me, so okay. Just a reminder, you should have received your communion elements when you arrive. And again, I just like to make sure that everybody knows that when the time comes, I will specifically instruct you so that we can eat together and drink together when the time comes. So let us now proceed to the Great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. In the beginning, your Spirit moved over the face of the waters. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. You made a covenant with our ancestors in faith, and you offer us the same promises through Christ. Your Spirit now dwells among us, empowering us, guiding us, and feeding our faith. And so, with your people in every land on earth and all the company of heaven, we join your unceasing praise. And earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. So on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." On that same night, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so we remember and we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ has come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, inside, outside, and online. Pour out your Spirit on these gifts of bread and cup, and make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. So by him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. As we partake in this holy meal with our Lord, let us share the prayer together out loud that he taught us, saying this: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the body of Christ given for you. Please now eat and be nourished. This is the blood of Christ, poured out for you. Drink now and have your thirst satisfied. Amen. Let us pray. O God, whose words did in fact speak us into existence and all things, God, we pray that this meal would nourish our souls, refilling us with the hope and joy that define our faith in you. May this holy feast sustain each one of us until that time that we gather at your table once again. In the name of Christ, our holy Redeemer, with faith in you, God, through Christ, our prayers are lifted up on this day and forever. Amen. Won't you please stand now for our closing hymn, number 519, which is a hymn of faith, by the way. Lift every voice and sing. A song that represents people living in hope, living in faith, without their vision realized at the time they were singing it. Music is a great way to restore your faith when it's flagging. Faith means being sure of the things we hope for and knowing that something is real even if we do not see it. That defines our faith in God. That defines us as a church. God is capable and God is worthy of your faith. and God will send you what you need when your faith starts to lag. Remember the songs that restore your faith. Remember your personal heroes of faith, for that is part of your story. And God will tell you when and empower you to share that story. For all of us, it is by faith that we are saved. And it is by faith that we can go out and serve others, that they too might be saved. So by the power of the God that created you, by the power of the God that now employs you, by the power of the God who now implores you, by the power of God and the faith of in Christ Jesus, go forth to love as Jesus taught. Go forth to serve as Jesus taught. You are able. So by faith, go forth and be the church. Amen.